Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to have you here today. Good morning, good morning. Okay, that's my Northeastern. It's just an honor to welcome you all here to the university today on behalf of Northeastern, President Ayoun, and our partners at the New England Council. We are really pleased to have Undersecretary Ted Mitchell, who has decided to give his final speech here at Northeastern University. We so value the robust relationship that we have had with the Department of Education under the Obama administration. From our work on the Perkins Loan Program to our most recent efforts on innovation in higher education with the EQUIP program, it's just a pleasure to work with this administration. And we are so fortunate to have had the kind of commitment to innovation and the kind of permission for innovation that this administration has encouraged. As many of the people in this room fully realize, Northeastern is all about innovation. We believe that higher education has an obligation to continue to innovate and to remove the fracturing or the chasm between work and learning. And we've done much work in this area, from co-op to our new level boot camp to our Align program to bring students who are in the non-technical fields into the technical fields, to XN, our project network that gives working adults the opportunity to access experiential learning, to EQUIP with our partnership in GE and ACE. The work with this administration has created that platform. It has created that enablement. And we are just so grateful and would like to personally thank you for the work that you have done to encourage us and to lead us into this space. I look forward to your remarks today, and I wish you well in your future endeavors. I'm pleased now to introduce Malachi Hernandez, who is a Torch Scholar here at Northeastern University. He'll tell a little bit about his story. We're so proud of Malachi and the other Torch Scholars, not the least for which is his most recent introduction of President Obama at my brother's Keeper event at the White House this past month. He will introduce our Undersecretary Mitchell. So Malachi, the floor is yours.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Dr. Mantella, for those wonderful words. It is an exciting opportunity to be here today in representing the student body of Northeastern University. And it is my pleasure to introduce to you the Undersecretary of Education, Mr. Ted Mitchell. My name is Malachi Hernandez. I'm a freshman here at Northeastern University, and I'm studying political science. I would like to thank Undersecretary Mitchell for all the work that he's done in regards to education and beyond. Listen closely as I'll begin to share my story as to why education is so important to students like me. I grew up in a low-income community in Boston, more specifically Dorchester, where to many, success seemed out of reach. There was a wide influence of drugs and violence right outside my doorsteps. Indoors at home, I witnessed domestic violence until my parents got divorced at the age of 7. However, despite the adversities, I always saw education as my cornerstone. I knew it was my way out of the environment that I didn't like growing up in. And long, tiring nights of studying from the difficult work of Boston Latin Academy was what my years looked like prior to this school. Thanks to the support of my mother, stepfather, and my mentors, I'm officially the first person in my family to be in college. But more importantly, a Torch Scholar at this university. Now I see the world for what it truly is, and I have goals of one day running for office, a goal that I would have never expected for myself. Undersecretary Ted Mitchell has served in this post since 2014 after being nominated by President Obama. As the Undersecretary, Dr. Mitchell has been charged with planning and policy responsibilities to implement President Obama's goal of for the U.S. to once again have the best educated, most competitive workforce in the world, as measured by the proportion of college graduates by the year 2020. In pursuit of President Obama's goal, Dr. Mitchell has overseen a number of key initiatives, including making it easier for students to access federal financial aid, including investments in the Pell Grant, and by streamlining the FAFSA form and making it available beginning in October, which has not only benefited me, but those in my community. He also provided more information to students and families in the college search process, including through the college scorecard. He's also worked tirelessly to protect students from predatory institutions of higher education. And lastly, he's expanded the scope of federal innovation in higher education through programs like First in the World and experiments such as Pell for Dual Enrollment, which empowers high school students to use Pell Grants to take college courses while still enrolled in high school. The work that Dr. Mitchell has done has greatly impacted many communities and those who are looking for higher educational opportunities. Because of this, it is my honor to introduce to you a man who is supporting the desire of wanting to see success from young adults like me. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me now in welcoming Undersecretary Ted Mitchell to the stage.
Malachi, I'm sorry for the downgrade. You went from the president to an undersecretary. That is not your trajectory in life. Thanks for the kind introduction, and Philly, thanks for the welcome to Northeastern. I have to say that when we called and asked if we could do this here, if I could give my final speech here, the response was, thank goodness. I wasn't quite sure how to think about it. I wasn't quite sure how to take that, but I'm really, really thrilled to be here. The progress that we have all made is testimony not just to my work or even the work of the department. It's testimony to the work that we've done together as colleagues and collaborators across the field, from institutions, public institutions, private institutions, two-year institutions, four-year institutions. We've all worked together, and I know we'll continue to do so in the future. It seems right to recognize this work here at Northwestern, one of the great American universities. Sorry, I knew I was going to do that at least once. At Northeastern, greater American university than those and those people who were stuck wearing purple, to hail these achievements at Northeastern, a great American university that builds on a proud legacy of excellence and opportunity that's rooted in robust and relevant research, innovative online learning, and one of the oldest and largest co-op programs in the country, linking what students are learning in the classroom with opportunities in the world of work. So in other words, our partnership with Northeastern makes this feel like home. And it is particularly so today because we're joined by a couple of my old and dear friends who helped get me into and through this business. Richard Collada, who served with distinction as the Director of Education Technology in the department and is now in the state of Rhode Island. Josh Lewis, who got me into this business a long time ago. And Tim Clifford, Northeastern alum, who today will be announcing an exciting partnership between his organization and the Boston Public Schools to provide better data to inform decision making. And my colleague and former boss, Chris Gabrielli, who is the chair of the Massachusetts Commission on Higher Education and served as a board member of the New Schools Venture Fund when I was there. So home this really is, and it's a privilege to be here. Just a few days remain of my time at the Department of Education in a position that I never dreamed I'd hold. It's been one of my life's great privileges, in large part because it's given me the opportunity to work with so many of you. So I appreciate your willingness to hear some parting thoughts from this lamest of ducks and to welcome you here today and to welcome those who are watching online. Northeastern's motto is light, truth, and courage. And to have come this far in providing opportunity for education to all Americans, we've needed all three. To continue that work, we'll need them all the more. Because the crucial challenge we share is to keep extending quality higher education to all Americans in a world in which all really needs to mean all. The fates of our students, the fate of our economy, and the fate of our democracy depend on this vital work. Because every morning, a veteran wakes up eager to turn the skills from her years of service and sacrifice into a new civilian career. Every day, a 50-year-old displaced worker races from his class at a community college to line up early at a career fair, hoping the certificate he is gaining helps to land the job that helps restore not just his income, but his dignity. Every evening, the day a blur of deadlines, bus schedules, and hurried meals, a single parent shuffles through a stack of bills and imagines completing the degree that will lead to a life-changing promotion. Every night, an undocumented college sophomore with a 4.0 GPA wonders if his dreams of graduating, his dreams of a good job, his dreams of a safe home for his family will end in happiness or heartbreak. And every day, students like Malachi struggle through domestic violence, violence in their streets, in their communities, to climb their way to American higher education. And yes, there are 18-year-olds hoping that this college application process works out right for them. These are the people we work for, a diverse tapestry woven with a common thread, the drive to get an education that betters individuals' lives and the lives of those who love and depend on them. Theirs are the hopes we aim to fulfill without exception and without exclusion. By doing so, we fulfill not only their hopes, but our common hopes for our country. Last week in her final speech as First Lady, Michelle Obama spoke about the principles for which our nation stands, and I quote, "Our glorious diversity, our diversities of faiths and colors and creeds, that's not a threat to who we are. It makes us who we are." And then she spoke directly to students. "Do not ever let anyone make you feel that you don't matter or like you don't have a place in our American story, because you do." Then she added, "But I also want to be very clear, this right isn't just handed to you. No, this right has to be earned every single day. You can't take your freedoms for granted. Just like generations who've come before you, you have to do your part to preserve and protect those freedoms." Higher education has been central to the American story, written over centuries, empowering individuals not only to advance their own station, but to engage in our democracy, to preserve and protect those freedoms. Our colleges and universities are communities that must strive each day to embody our highest aspirations for our country. Today, that means they must not only be bulwarks of intellectual rigor and academic excellence, but also of liberty and equality, diversity and inclusiveness, freedom and opportunity. If we retreat from those, we risk not just the integrity of our institutions, but the viability of our democracy. We need to remember that these values are not evident in many parts of the world. I once spent time cooling my heels under armed guard, waiting for an audience with an autocrat who was trying to hobble the academic freedom of his island state's flagship university. He feared the independent thinking that characterizes higher education. He did not see that higher education made his people stronger, not weaker. Needless to say, we didn't get on very well. While great American thinkers in every generation have hailed education's power to promote prosperity, social mobility, and democratic engagement, the idea and the ideal of post-secondary education for all is a rather modern one and signals an important shift in higher education. It is a shift fueled by advances in civil rights and by demands of a changing world. Today's competitive global economy demands post-secondary education for even entry-level work in many fields. As recently as the 1970s, people with only a high school education could qualify for nearly three-quarters of the nation's jobs. By 2020, that number will drop by more than half. Moreover, the steady loss of manufacturing jobs that were available to non-college adults is striking. Those jobs are going away, and they're not coming back. Income inequality has been growing in America at a staggering pace, and a yawning wealth divide separates many families of color from their white peers. While education alone can't close those gaps, it's an essential part of the solution because, as we know, last year college graduates earned on average 70% more than those with just a high school diploma. And our democracy depends on an informed, educated citizenry. Jefferson was clear, and I quote, "If a nation expects to be ignorant and free, it expects what never was and never will be," end quote. The issues we face as a democratic community, from international relations and poverty to the local city budget and policing, are complicated and getting more so. So the stakes have never been higher for post-secondary education, and post-secondary attainment has never been more important. And that's why, as Malachi noted, in his first days in office, President Obama challenged the United States to reclaim its distinction of leading the world in post-secondary degrees and credentials. We call that goal our North Star goal, and it's lit the way for several important shifts in priorities and philosophy over time. We've acknowledged that we have both a math problem and a moral problem, that to reach the president's goal, to reach the goal for the country, we will need to open the doors of higher education to students who are usually excluded from college or don't have the opportunity to go. We've moved from seeing college as a luxury to recognizing that affordable quality degrees and certificates are essential for anyone to advance in today's knowledge economy. And we've moved from focusing on inputs like enrollment and spending toward outcomes as the measure of success in higher education, including completion rates, degrees awarded, and whether those degrees have real value in the marketplace. Access will always matter, but only if students who start finish. These are important changes, and we must not slide back. Our collective commitment to access, affordability, and completion of high-quality degrees and certificates for all students must remain strong if we're to sustain economic prosperity and the health of the democracy. But as we need to maintain that commitment, we must go about it in new ways. We must innovate. And there is no clearer reason for this than the changing nature of our students themselves. Often still, when we think of the typical college student, we conjure up a picture of mom and dad and their 18-year-old pulling up to a dorm on a leafy state university campus and dropping them off, expecting fully that 4 years later, they'll return on graduation day. But in 2017, our college hopefuls represent a variety of different backgrounds, different needs, different experiences, different circumstances and contexts. Our mission and our goal must be to help them all succeed, and we will not do that by doing the same thing over and over again. In fact, what were yesterday's non-traditional students are today's new normal. And I've met with and learned from hundreds of them during my time as undersecretary. They are students like Darby Connolly, a mother of three who works full time. After high school, she started at a four-year college and then dropped out to earn a living. She rose in her job from a customer service representative to a manager. But she knew that no matter how hard she worked, without a bachelor's degree, some doors would remain closed. Darby returned to school but felt awkward as the oldest student, and juggling studies, work, and family proved too hard. Next, she tried an online program, but missed the personal connections and the clear ties between her work and her career goals. And so she put her higher education on the shelf again. For many people, the story ends there, but for Darby, it did not. She did not end up, as so many do, with only debt and no degree. So she tried a fourth time, enrolling in a self-paced, competency-based learning program at Southern New Hampshire University's College for America program, a program built around the needs of today's new normal students. That was Darby's turning point. She moved quickly through what she had already learned and focused on mastering new skills. She had support from her company and, importantly, a group of coworkers who enrolled together in a cohort. Today, she has her associate's degree and is advancing toward her bachelor's. Students like Darby are knocking on the doors of all of our colleges and universities, and in record numbers. But there aren't enough programs like Southern New Hampshire's tailored to their needs. Too many colleges operate as if all of their students fit the old stereotype, that 18-year-old taking 15 credit hours per semester, working each summer, and finishing an associate's in 2 years or a bachelor's in four. That model still serves many students well, but for those who are older, who have families, who work full-time, first-generation low-income students, who in many cases are underprepared for the rigors of college work, that approach is a barrier to reaching educational goals. Yes, we expect students to work hard at their studies and sacrifice to get a college certificate or degree, but we shouldn't make it harder than it needs to be. We should make it easier, we should make it cheaper and quicker while ensuring or even expanding quality. That's been the special magic here at Northeastern. We all, the federal government, state governments, and institutions have a responsibility to do what it takes to help the new normal students succeed. I lived for nearly a decade in a small hamlet called Stratford, Vermont. And I'd often walk from my house to the historic homestead of our most famous resident, Justin Morrill, who served in the US Senate during and after the Civil War. Justin Morrill authored the Morrill Act, which was signed into law by Abraham Lincoln in 1862. It created land-grant colleges throughout America and laid, in Morrill's words, a sure and perpetual foundation accessible to all, but especially to the sons of toil. Over time, Morrill's idea and the land-grant colleges democratized access to education for women, for people of color, and for students from poor families who would never have expected to go to college. And that democratization would serve not just the individual interests of students, but the nation's interest. The Morrill Act was only a step to all means all. And in 1890, faced with the brutal fact of the exclusion of African Americans from land-grant institutions, Morrill pushed new legislation to advance their enrollment in land-grant colleges. As he said, African Americans, said blacks, are members of the American family, and their advancement concerns us all. 17 historically black colleges and universities owe their existence to this second Morrill Act, and we owe Morrill a great debt in signaling the importance of public investment in higher education to expand opportunity for all. This is just one example of the nation's step-by-step journey toward fulfilling our ideals and extending their promise to everyone. Today, the members of the American family are more diverse than ever, and it's truer still, in Morrill's words, that their advancement concerns us all. But we have work to do. College completion rates continue to hover around 50%. Completion rates for African American and Latino students continue to lag, though they are improving. Students from families in the lowest income quartile are 7 times less likely to attain a bachelor's degree than their peers in the highest income quartile. This is unacceptable. These outcomes hobble our economy, endanger our democracy, and threaten the idea of the American dream. The good news is that thanks to many of you in this room, we are making progress. Last year's graduating class was the largest, most diverse in our nation's history. 1 million more African American and Hispanic students are in college today than 8 years ago. A record number of students are using Pell Grants to support their education. And at the other end, the number of student loan defaults is trending down. Malachi noted in the beginning, we've tried to do our part. We've created tools like the College Scorecard and the Financial Aid Shopping Sheet to provide better information to families as they make important college-going decisions. Making FAFSA easier and moving the deadline forward enables students and families to know their eligibility for federal aid while they're applying for college. We've also ended student loan subsidies for private banks, shifting more than $60 billion in savings back to students and taxpayers. We've cracked down on bad actors who leave students with debt but meaningless credentials. And we've shined a light on schools that are committing to student success. including those highlighted in the department's 2016 College Completion Toolkit. This resource, designed by and for institutional leaders, features data-driven practices from some of the colleges and universities that are doing the much-needed work of promoting student success. And finally, we've made it easier for students to pay back their student loans by creating income-based repayment plans that cap payments at 10% of earnings. But let's be clear, improving federal student aid and focusing even on best practices is not and cannot be the sole solution to making college more affordable and ensuring completion for the new normal student. We must turn back the tide of state disinvestment in higher education in order to make true progress. Altogether, funding for public 2- and 4-year colleges adjusted for inflation is nearly $10 billion less than it was before the recession. Community colleges in many states have been particularly hard hit. Arizona, for example, this year took the unprecedented step of zeroing out the budget for 2 of the state's largest community colleges. Over the past 30 years, damaging cuts like these have caused major tuition hikes at public institutions, which educate 7 out of 10 students in our nation, burdening students and families with greater debt. And increasingly, these higher costs and this debt falls on the shoulders of low-income families who can least afford it, who, in income and wealth, have far fewer resources to support student debt than other families. More state legislatures and Congress must recognize the importance, as Morrill did, of public investments in American higher education. And so I'm calling on lawmakers at all levels to renew the public compact with higher education, to reinvest in colleges and universities, and to make the kind of public investment that has deep roots in our history, but more importantly, is an all-important foundation for our future. That's why President Obama proposed his America's College Promise program, which aims to make 2 years at community colleges, historically black colleges and MSIs, tuition-free for qualified students. This was based on the Tennessee Promise program. It was enacted by the state of Tennessee, and prior to that, even the Kalamazoo Promise program in that community. All of this to say that the idea of public support for higher education is percolating in the country. It is alive. It's not quite well yet, but it's alive. It's our job to make it both alive and well. Since the president's announcement, more than 20 states and communities have created their own promise programs, including, most recently, New York. These commitments, again, are recognition of both the public purposes of higher education and the public responsibility to broaden access, improve affordability, and ensure completion. But as I've said before, we can't reach our North Star goal and serve our diverse student population by simply doing more of the same. That's why we've been working with you to support innovation that advances excellence and equity, innovation that helps our new normal students and helps all students succeed. To do that work will require continued creativity and a bold vision for what higher education can be, transforming the work we already do and inventing the work that we haven't yet imagined. We supported that kind of innovation with our First in the World grant program and our experimental site authority. And I think Northeastern may be one of the only institutions that has participated in both of those. For example, 2 of our First in the World grantees have developed new approaches to enrich student outcomes and streamline pathways to degrees. By using technology to analyze and respond to student needs, in student progress, Georgia State has doubled, and in some cases nearly tripled, graduation rates by race and ethnicity over the past decade in a school with a very large Pell-eligible population and high enrollments for students of color. Those weren't the only changes Georgia State made. They found that many students switched majors several times before graduating, causing them to lose credit toward their major over time. Take more courses, more time, more money. In response, the university introduced broader meta majors and within 2 years, the number of changed majors had fallen by 32%, saving students time and the cost of unnecessary credits. At LaGuardia Community College, a part of the CUNY system in New York, which caters to students representing over 100 languages in 150 countries, micro-interventions in the form of targeted advising, free metro cards, help with childcare, changed degree attainment by twofold. So these macro changes at LaGuardia have had micro changes have had macro results. Looking ahead, the future of higher education will likely include new business models for today's institutions, and it will include the emergence of new educational providers of high-quality learning. For instance, as is already happening, learning may happen across a student's lifetime. Students may subscribe to an institution rather than enrolling for a set period of time or a specific degree. Learning will likely be measured in new ways and certified in new ways, perhaps through badges and micro-credentials, as well as traditional degrees. To meet the needs of our students, we'll need to develop institutions, systems, and yes, policy to support new ways of teaching, learning, and assessment. By doing this, we will free learning from the constraints of time and space, course schedules, office hours, lecture halls, and allow educators and students to focus on the mastery of skills and concept. Several of our institutions are already leading the way through initiatives in competency-based education. The University of Wisconsin's Flexible Option Program allows students to work through a degree or a certificate program at their own pace. This isn't an add-on. It's a core design element. And with many institutions launching competency-based education programs, including some with the department, we will learn more about the effectiveness of competency-based approaches in improving student outcomes. We'll also gain new insights into partnerships between colleges and new providers, new approaches to quality assurance. Our EQUIP program is designed to do just that. Our goal is to test new ways for students from all backgrounds to access innovative learning and training opportunities that lead to good jobs, but that fall outside the current higher ed system, financial aid system. A second goal is to strengthen and broaden outcome-based quality assurance processes that focus on student learning. Northeastern has joined us in this effort and is working with General Electric and the American Council on Education to provide a bachelor's degree in advanced manufacturing. With EQUIP, we aim to measure the impact of these approaches on college access, affordability, and student outcomes, and scale what works. Now, let's be clear. I'm not talking about bright, shiny object innovation that sounds good but doesn't deliver, and I'm not naive about opportunists looking to make a quick buck in areas where the standards are still being defined, where evaluations are scarce, and students are easy targets with federal funds flowing. Nor am I focused solely on technology as the savior that will miraculously transform education, as some tech devotees would have it. Metro cards aren't high tech. Using data analytics to predict who needs them, now that's more like it. I do believe technology can fuel tremendous improvements in education, from enhancing teaching, learning, and assessment to supporting and guiding students to their goals. In fact, later today at MIT, we will unveil a supplement to our National Education Technology Plan that focuses on higher education. The plan presents a shared vision and a call to action for transformational technology-enabled learning. The higher education supplement covers learning, teaching, leadership, assessment, and infrastructure, suggesting ways that technology can serve our increasing number of diverse learners who come to us with such a wide range of educational goals and personal circumstances. The higher education supplement also reinforces the idea that outcomes ought to be the central measure of quality, because that's precisely how we encourage responsible innovation. We focus on student outcomes, we hold institutions accountable, we scale up only those innovations that make a real difference for students so that more folks like Darby gain the skills and opportunities to transform their lives. Whether high tech or low tech, I'm talking about innovation that powers a system that makes quality higher education more accessible, more affordable, and more effective in ensuring that students who start finish. Innovation that expands access and closes the completion gap between rich and poor, African Americans, Latinos, and whites, and that thereby serves individuals, serves their communities, and serves the nation. That's what our focus is this morning, and that is our charge for the mornings that follow. Whenever and wherever a student entrusts her dreams and destiny to a college or university, we have a solemn bond to do whatever it takes to meet her unique needs so that she can fulfill her promise and her dreams. In that, we must make room for new Americans, for vulnerable Americans, for first-generation students, low-income students, students with disabilities, and older adults. We must make room for the new normal college student. And we must innovate, not just in technical ways, to support their pathways to success. We must acknowledge and celebrate their success as our success, their achievements as our achievements. And we must understand that their American dreams help fulfill our dream of America, an America in which prosperity, equality, and justice are shared by all, and an America where fear, division, and opportunism are always, always defeated by hope, aspiration, and opportunity. This will take an acknowledgement of the truths, good and bad, about the work we have done and the work we must do. It must be buoyed by the frequent acknowledgement and celebration of the light that illuminates our successes, and it will take the courage to remain constant to the highest ideals of our country and our democracy. Reverend King, whose birthday we celebrate this weekend, said that, quote, "The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice." It's important for us to remember that that arc bends not because of some moral physics, but because of the hard and courageous work of individuals and institutions. I know you are engaged in that work and committed to that work, and I thank you for your courage, your creativity, and your perseverance. And I implore you to redouble your efforts and to support the hopes and dreams of untold numbers of students who come to us looking for a way to have their shot in their own lives and the lives of this country. Reach them, protect them, nurture them, create systems that serve them, and they and we will thrive. I pledge to be your partner in that, wherever our paths may take us next, and together to help bend that moral arc toward justice for all of our sake. And I want to thank you for your generous support, your guidance, and your patience as we've worked on these important issues together. It has really been my great pleasure to serve our students, to serve you and our institutions and our nation. Thank you.
These parting messages, and I know you're hardly done with your work, are important moments, and it's clear to me, and I think everyone in this audience, you put a lot of thought into both the specifics and the points about the arc and where we're headed. So I certainly feel like I want to go back to the office and get to work, but we get a few minutes for me to ask a couple of questions, and more importantly, to get the audience in. I mean, one that leaped to my mind, Ted, was, you know, you really called out on all of us to think about these new normal students and to think about the greater range of students at every part of life, every circumstance coming forward. If you were an institutional leader, and there are a lot in this room, how many of you are in leadership of a higher ed institution here in Massachusetts or beyond? So there's quite a few people who could go back to their office and think about one or two things they should be working on right now. What would you put, give us some advice, what would you put really high on your list of specific, you know, programmatic or other directions that we should have prioritized to at least explore?
One of the reasons I wanted to do this at Northeastern and wanted to come back to Boston is to acknowledge not only Northeastern's great work here but institutions in the area. So I want to start from it's a matter of building on what's already going on. So Essex Community College starting a competency-based program nowish, right? So I think the ball is moving.
Essex. We don't know about Southern Essex.
Oh, okay, Northern Essex. But I think, you know, I think if I were picking not either a place to start or a place to push, it would be on doing everything that we can at the institutional level to break the tyranny of time and space and to really create programs, opportunities, pathways that are more tailored to the where students are, what their other obligations are, and to begin to match those. Competency-based education is one way to do that. There are also ways of just changing the calendar, changing the schedule, making things different. So I think that there are small things we can do, there are big things we can do, and then there are enormous things that we can do when we really begin to harness some of the new technologies, some of the learning science-driven assessments, so that we can break the tyranny of time and space.
Wow, time and that's a lot of dimensionality to go after us, but it's a good way to think about it, a really different way, right, to start with that point. Can't help but want to ask you personally, you were generous in calling me your boss. Any of you can imagine what it'd be like to be on the board of directors with Ted as a CEO. It was an easy job, follow the leader and cheer him on, by and large. But I think it was a striking moment when Ted came to us and said the president was going to appoint him to this position, because everybody on the board unanimously thought, what a great thing for our country, what a crappy thing for our organization. So we had that terrible, you know, moment of, you know, do what's right for the community, even if it's bad for your organization. But you came to that job so extraordinarily well prepared, having been, you know, president of a university, having been involved as an academic, your own academic discipline focuses on the history of education in the United States. You'd also been a public official in California as president of the board of education, advisor to the governor. You'd been involved in innovation through New Schools Venture Fund and helping, you know, create entrepreneurial entities, nonprofit and for profit in the education space. So you really came about as well prepared as someone could be. Nonetheless,
I can't keep a job.
That too. Saying. Nonetheless, I'm sure there were a couple things that, you know, surprised you from that vantage point. And I don't know if that's appropriate to ask, but I think it'd be interesting to understand, like, what was it you came to understand that you didn't really get till you had this awesome job of the entire U.S. education system?
It's a great question, and just to be clear, New Schools has gotten a lot better since I left. I just want to be clear about that. So it was a good thing. You know, so moving from New Schools, where on any given day in our office here in Boston, or in our office in Washington, and our office in San Francisco, there were maybe 40 people around. We could basically have the entire team retreat in this room to an organization that not only is the 4,000 person Department of Education, but then is the overall administration. I think that the pathway to getting things done was more complicated than I even anticipated. And I abstractly, you know those things, but to work that through day to day has been an interesting challenge.
More to come in the memoirs. One more question that I want to throw to the audience, because there's so many people here with such knowledge, and I'm sure they're eager to access your perspectives today and beyond. You know, as you think about, it certainly is, since I've been board chair here for higher ed, an area I knew much less about before I got engaged, you know, it struck me as a classic kind of, I don't want to over-acknowledge one particular theory, but sort of Clay Christensen problem, that higher ed is a wonderful collection of enterprises, both public institutions and private, that are fulfilling many of the needs and desires of their constituencies as they are. And some of the things you're talking about, some of the things others are interested in, would require, you know, pretty significant breaks from. They're not necessarily always evolutionary, even as you say, let's build on it. What do you think institutionally one people should be thinking about in order to both maintain, you know, the demands, speaking of the 4,000, I mean, most of the leaders in this audience have very complicated institutions of their own with hundreds or if not thousands of employees and students and, you know, all the day in, day out. And yet change of real in real direction and scale is hard to do that way. Any thoughts on what, you know, you've thought a lot about innovation, both at the governmental level and, you know, the private sector, nonprofit level and so forth. What is just something that we all ought to be doing more of or differently in order to foster both our day jobs and our long-term change jobs.
So I think that kind of change management it's tough. It's really hard, and figuring out how to do it is really hard. I think this is where one of our hopes is that I think one of the difficulties in moving institutions that have been doing okay for a long time into a world where the production process is not as certain is the overall bet that you have to make, an abstract bet that the world is going to be different and better. So I'm a big fan of experimentation, internal experimentation in small groups. I think that we've actually evolved a kind of theory of change in the department about that, about supporting small-scale innovation, about evaluating the heck out of it, looking at what the outcomes are, making sure that we're separating those that have good outcomes from those that don't, scaling the ones that do, abandoning the ones that don't, and then finally, arranging policy around that so that you can get more of the good stuff to happen more easily. It's where our focus on outcomes and our work with Barbara Brittingham is here with accreditors and others to focus on quality student outcomes, I think provides a pathway to taking a lot of the uncertainty out about what really happens if you make changes. But I would urge small scale experimentation, rigorous evaluation, and then moving through to larger scale implementation.
Fabulous. Want to get the audience engaged? Do you all have thoughts, questions?
I'm curious
can you identify yourself? Sorry.
I'm Chris Mallett from Northeastern. Just pick up on this theme of experimentation. The experimental sites initiatives around CBE and EQIP are doing exactly what you just said, laying that foundation, and yet we're in this time of transition. So can you talk a little bit about their continuity and what you can project in terms of the ability to keep leaning into that bureaucratic change that also has to happen to make the experiments able to take hold?
Yeah. So to be clear about a couple things, so I can't speculate about the policies or the priorities of the incoming administration. We're committed and have been working to make the transition as successful as possible, mm-hmm. Because the work is the central part. So we think that the experimental sites and EQIP, CBE, Malachi mentioned the dual enrollment experimental site, Second Chance Pell for incarcerated adults. We have a new one on loan counseling. We think we've got a really robust portfolio of experiments going. They're set, they're in place for at least 3 years. One of the things that's important to remember about the transition is that, yes, the political team will leave, but the super high quality career team that's charged with carrying out the experimental sites, for example, they will continue. They will be there. They will be there on the 23rd of January, picking up the material from their inbox that came in before the inaugural. And I think, Chris, going back to your question about surprise, I think, like many people, I didn't know what to expect in the work with the career people. But you know, these are men and women who are absolutely dedicated to the work that they do. They are extraordinarily talented, intellectually, far more adept politically than some political newbies like me. And so I feel very good about the core strength of the Education Department and its career team.
Hi, I'm Andrew Sillerson from Campus Compact. And you mentioned the importance of academic freedom, and you know, I think we've all seen some of the threats to that. I think there's a new bill yesterday introduced in Iowa threatening tenure. We saw this week a report from the National Association of Scholars claiming that service learning, civic engagement are actually kind of leftist indoctrination, and calling for defunding a whole set of programs, et cetera. And I just wonder, with the experience you have, what your advice is for those of us who care about the protection of academic freedom and the public role of higher education.
Academic freedom is under fire. There's a report out this week that community engagement programs are indoctrination. How best can this community respond to those? I think that we have not done our best work yet in writing the narrative. That's both WR and RIGH, around this, the trade-off between education, both K-12 and higher ed, as an individual good and a public good. It's not one or the other, it's both. And I think we need to be sharper and clearer and more vocal about the important balance between those two and the policies that then have to flow from it, whether that's policies restoring state investment in higher education, making sure that academic freedom, which is the basis on which light, truth, and courage promote excellence here and elsewhere, that those are sustained. And I think we need to be clearer about why and how.
Yes.
Good morning. My name is Sandy Doran. I'm with the New England Board of Higher Education, and I want to thank you for your commitment to innovation, equity, high-quality distance education. As you are aware, the department issued some regulations late in 2016 addressing the state authorization and reciprocity agreement. So we have been fielding calls in our office from the 47 states that are members and the 1,400 institutions that are members around some of those comments and regulations. So I'm hoping you can shed some light on the intention of those regulations.
Pleasure to do that. And I'm sorry for some of you if we're getting a little into the weeds, but it's important.
About 60 people slumped in their chair and about five really perked up. I'm one of the five, so go please.
Exactly. So I'll go for it. And thanks for the opportunity to clarify. Sometimes regulation language doesn't reflect to everybody exactly what it's meant to say. And so we've been having some phone calls with some of your colleagues and peers about this as well. So the intent of the regulation is twofold in regard to reciprocity. First and foremost, it is to support reciprocity agreements between states, to allow institutions, high quality institutions, to operate across the state lines without undue burden. So we intend to support reciprocity. Second, in the comments that we received from folks during the comment period, it became clear that we also needed to say that those reciprocity agreements didn't supersede any existing state laws. And so we need and want to support a balance between reciprocity agreements and allowing states to maintain their authorities under the statutes enacted in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, the state of California, wherever. So this was definitely not meant to be, nor do we believe that it is, a pointed jab at reciprocity agreements, rather creating the groundwork where reciprocity can coexist with state function. Pleasure. Those are good weeds.
Hi, J.C. Constantine from Pearson. I'm just wondering what you think about the prospects of higher ed reauthorization this year, and what are your thoughts on opportunities for innovation in that?
So the question was, going to be my question too, was I just am repeating it because the fellow in the back's pointing out you can't without the microphone. The question is a higher ed authorization renewal and prospects, and I think maybe key content. Yeah.
So I read the same news that you do. And I think that it's clear that Senate leaders have said that they're very interested in taking up the Higher Ed Act. I think that was true before the election, and I think that I have every expectation that that'll be one of the things on the agenda early. As far as content, can't speculate either about the new team or how the dynamic might shift with the election.
I want to ask you about, you know, you talked about the new normal student, and you got into, I think, thinking about this sort of lifelong learning arc, and of course there's this whole competencies versus and credentials versus degrees aspect of that too, and so on. But help us think a little more about that issue. It's something I've personally been thinking a lot about, right, is that it's, you know, it's hard for institutions, I think, to think outside the most institutions outside the degree, not necessarily the 18-year-old, but certainly the degree. And yet we have so many people in our state, in our country, who have some college, just as you gave in the example, but didn't graduate or have high school, but no college, and obviously are not going to get into the sweet part of the economic opportunity and arguably even ability to fully participate in society without more. What do you see as some of the keys for institutions to be thinking about that? Very different constituency that's not normally come to their doors, may not know that there's anything to be offered to them and so forth.
I see this as an enormous opportunity for all of us, whether that's at the college completion space, where identifying those individuals and figuring out how far they are from a degree and developing programs to help them get over the finish line. I think that's an enormous, relatively untapped demand and supply ought to follow. I think that another place where there's a huge opportunity is in continuing for institutions that may be degree focused to continue to enhance and build on those degrees, so that even a PhD isn't a terminal degree. To add to it certificates and specializations that round out the picture of what an individual is able to do, and for institutions to develop programs that, again, aren't about the next degree, but are in smaller bite-sized pieces that can add to a profile. I think the trick in all of that is how do you certify the learning? And I think that's where the competency-based work is really helping us out. And how do you keep track of it? How do you keep track of it in a smaller size than is usually recognized on a resume or in a CV or even in a LinkedIn profile? So I think working on all of those is going to be really exciting and really interesting for institutions. Not everybody will do everything. Not every institution's mission is suited to that whole marketplace. But I do think that the opportunity is really out there.
Yes.
Sam Johnston from CAST. And I'm just curious about what your thoughts are about when you think about retention research. I would say that others would say that not enough of that research is really focused at the classroom level. And then our sort of research instruments and methods aren't usually sensitive enough to really understand when we innovate at the classroom level, either in teaching or learning or innovations around technology. Actually get into understanding what changes innovations generate. So I'm curious to, in the sort of imperative around innovation, what we might do to focus more energy around looking at the classroom as a key part of what helps students either persist or not, especially when we sort of try to think about what you refer to as the new normal student.
So the question was about whether the research apparatus that we have is sensitive enough at the classroom level to understand the effects of different kinds of innovations.
But just also as well close? As sort of the share of energy that goes into that type of research as opposed to research on things like changes around, support for students around advising or support for students around block scheduling and things like that. So, how much investment we're doing in looking at research at the classroom level, and then are our current methods and instruments actually effective for that type of research?
Yep. So it's a great set of questions, and I think we need the short answer is we need to invest more in a research agenda at the classroom level in classroom dynamics. We don't have enough. When I talked to Darby Conley, the woman I profiled in the talk, and she talked about this online program that she took, and it just didn't. The interaction was just not good for her. And I think that's not an indictment of online programs. It's just it raises the question of what kinds of interactions work for what kinds of students in what circumstances. The danger of an outcome-based focus is you create a black box, that you have the innovation and you have the outcome, and we need to study what happens in that black box in order to be able to make really sensible decisions about interventions in order to tweak and iterate the innovations themselves to address different issues that come up in the process. And I agree with the implied criticism, not of anyone in particular, but the concern that we don't spend enough time looking at the classroom dynamics and their impact on retention. But we do know this research better than I do. We know that at one level of magnitude up from that, we know the critical importance of sustained, trusting interactions with a responsible faculty member, a mentor at an institution, we know how essential that is. And if we were to then play that back and say, all right, what kinds of classroom interactions support that and what don't, then I think we can probably begin to get to the answer to the question.
We've come, unfortunately, to the end of our time. I know you've got a lot you're packing in these last days. Did you see someone you wanted to get one last question from?
Josh seems to have a question.
All right. It's always the prerogative, right, of David, let me allow him to do it. All right. Josh.
My name is Josh Lewis, and I'm a friend of Chris Gabrielli. He's also up there. Ted, perhaps you could put your historian of education back on just at the highest level. Give us the sweep. Where are we now? You know, setting aside whatever you think about the outcome of this election, it had revealed spectacular fractures and fissures in the society, and many of them have to do with education, even though education policy wasn't much discussed. And so, you know, as we all know, education evolves with society, its codependent relationship, labor force, and economy, and so forth and so on. So, where are we now? Broad, open-ended question, but I know it's topical.
Our time is up, right?
Is that where education is at now?
Where's education? In the broad sweep of the history of education, where are we, and what have the last several months revealed about that? So I think, you know, there are two broad brush things to remind ourselves of when we are feeling down about the state of higher education. One is that we are educating more Americans across a broader spectrum of backgrounds and abilities than we ever have before. And we've come, it's number two, and we've come to expect success from those individuals. And that's big. And so today we really have been talking about, if you expect that kind of success, what do you do to help promote it? I think one of the things that we have emphasized access, and we now need to catch up on a couple of the other important elements of what success really looks like. Affordability, we need to do all we can to increase public investment in higher education. We need to do what we can at the institutional level to target resources where they matter and make a difference. And critically, this idea of high-quality outcomes that are connected with what students want to do in their lives. I think we have been slow to connect higher ed outcomes, not just with employment per se, but with changing dynamics in the economy. And we need to be sharper-eyed and keener focused on making those connections. This is what our students are telling us. This is what the new normal student is certainly telling us, and I think that disjuncture and that discomfort has had a great deal of impact in the way people across America feel about higher education.
Well, that's a great question to close on, the sweeping look, and I just want to say on behalf of Massachusetts, on behalf of Northeastern, even though I have no authorization to speak for this university, at a personal level, you know, here in Massachusetts, we're hoping that higher ed and education in general remains what we're known for, a little more than our cranberries, maybe not quite as much as our Patriots.
It is an honor that you would pick this place at this moment to give your final comments here as in your current role. We all know you'll be totally in the game. This is hardly goodbye, Ted.
But goodbye, Undersecretary Ted, and thank you all for coming out this morning. Thank you, Ted, for honoring us with your presence.
Thank you, Chris, and thanks to my colleagues at Northeastern.